Hey, jet people. We're here in front of the Arenda 14 turbojet engine for an F-86F Sabre, at least the Canadian version, which is known as the CL-13 Sabre. Anyway, they both look exactly the same on the outside. Very cool plane. We're nearing the completion of this project, and I have very good news. Hang on. Okay, these are two fuel pumps on a gearbox, and these are not the ones for the engine. We use these ones as part of our test rig for the fuel control. This is a, what would you call it, a practice dummy and also a spare parts donor. You can maybe tell the difference between that one and this one. This one is freshly overhauled, calibrated, and tested. Oh, she's a beauty. That's number two, that's the right-hand pump. This is the left-hand pump, and it is freshly back from overhaul, testing, and calibration. So what I'm doing over the next little while is putting that and this together with the freshly overhauled gearbox we have so that it looks like this, and then we're gonna drop it on top of the engine. So if you wanna follow the entire process right from dragging all the surplus engines out and disassembling them and getting the very best parts from them and all the new parts we can to build this thing. And you want to go to Patreon/AgentJZ, AgentJZ, AgentJZulu. Anyway, the best bang for the buck. It's basically a course on how to restore this engine. So if you're a student of gas turbine engines, aircraft engines, you might find it interesting, and it's not expensive. What is it? It's for the cost of less than one beer per month. There's hundreds of hours of detailed step-by-step reviews of how I do this. Anyway, that's not why we're here right now. Okay, so right now it's Super Bowl Sunday, 2024, about an hour and a half before kickoff. It starts later than I thought. Why am I here? Two reasons. I'm not a football fan or a hockey fan or a basketball fan or a baseball fan. None of those things interest me. I'm not against them. It's always fun to watch a good game, but I was never interested in those things when I was a kid, and not now. When all my friends were watching hockey games, I was watching, it was European at the time, Grand Prix motorcycle racing, MotoGP that it's called now, things like that. So I'm a weirdo, yep. And when everybody else, not everybody, but a lot of my friends had that big poster of Farrah Fawcett, you know the one, on their door, I had hanging models of World War II aircraft in my room. And one of my favorites was the B-25 Mitchell, the one that wasn't, I was trying to convert my model into the one I wanted it to be, not the the medium bomber. I wanted to make what they later called the Commerce Destroyer, which the nose had 850 cals in it and one on either side. So if you want to wreck stuff on the ground and hurt people, 10 forward-firing 50 caliber machine guns is gonna get you started. Anyway, that's me. Hopefully I didn't disappoint you all. I'm not really a football fan. I'll watch a little bit. I'll watch the highlights. What interests me most about the Super Bowl 2024? Oh, that one thing, and then the commercials. So it'd be really cool if one of the commercials had that one thing in it, which would be super cool, but it doesn't really matter. It's most entertaining to me to see the buildup and the fervor and the excitement, and that's always good. Got nothing to complain about there. Anyway, the main reason we're here is because this is a rare video. It's the same day response to an inspiration. And I was watching, let me get the title here from my phone so I get it right. I was watching the Hopajet Challenger 604 crash, Naples, Florida, February 9th, 2024, by Blancolirio. Now, if you don't know Blancolirio, you should check out his channel because he is, and I'm a subscriber, what is it, $5 a month or something. But anyway, he's by far the best source that I've found for aviation-related knowledge, vastly superior to any television network The network television aviation specialists, pardon my French, they're idiots, all of them. They're morons. Now, Blancolirio is a 777 pilot, so he knows about all those radio calls, all those instruments, all those procedures, all the stuff you have to do to land a plane with 300 people in it safely, and all that other stuff. If you want the inside scoop on everything, everything, you talk to Blancolirio. Now, he's my favorite, but there's also many other great aviation content related channels on YouTube. Just off the top of my head, 74 Gear, Mentor Now or Mentor Pilot, might be the same guy. There's a guy called Hoover on Pilot Debrief. He's really good. And of course, I've got the camera effect happening now. My brain's not working. I can't think of any other ones, and I apologize because there's probably 20 that are really, really good. And they're by people who actually deal with aircraft and aviation. They're either pilots or I think most of them are pilots. Anyway, so I have my little bit of contribution here. When I watch those guys, I realize that I don't know a lot about airplanes. I think I do, but I don't deal with airplanes. I deal with the engines. So there's something very interesting on the Blancolirio's latest video. It's not a Cessna Citation, it's a Bombardier Challenger 600. Anyway, a beautiful twin jet aircraft, beautiful aircraft, and it flew from Florida up to somewhere in the Midwest, I think, and it came back. So it was like 1,600 miles in total, and the plane has a total range of like 3,200 miles, so should be no problem. So everybody's wondering about fuel, because I don't think they gassed up before they came back. Anyway, there's a lot of talk about the fuel system of the Challenger in Blancolirio's video, which is excellent. I recommend it. And he mentions there's many fuel tanks and fuel transfer pumps, engine-driven fuel pumps, and he talks about boost pumps. So, one of the interesting things to see from he's got illustrations on his video about the fuel tanks in the Challenger. And it's a small to medium size business jet. I guess it's a medium to large size business jet, but it's a small to medium size airliner. There's a slightly larger version of that aircraft called the CRJ, the Canada Regional Jet. Anyway, it was developed from the Bombardier. Anyway, there's a lot of fuel tanks on a jet airliner, even a small one. And contrary to what you will hear from a significantly annoying number of morons, jet engines use a lot of fuel. They make a lot of power. And so you need a lot of fuel to make that power. So the engine-driven fuel pump is what actually feeds the fuel to the fuel nozzles. It goes from the fuel pump to the fuel control to the fuel nozzles. The engine-driven fuel pump is positive displacement. It's capable of, up to 2,000 pounds per square inch of pressure. And it supplies an extremely reliable, precisely metered amount of fuel, which is then further tweaked and massaged and controlled by the fuel control. So what's coming out the fuel nozzles to make that power is extremely accurately metered and controlled. Yes. So you got a pump that's going to deliver 20 gallons per minute to your engine. It's on the engine. It's driven by the engine. It cannot stop, it can't fail because it's mechanically directly driven off a gearbox on the engine. That's great. Okay, so what's a transfer pump? A transfer pump will move from one tank to another. In the larger airlines, they have transfer pumps, but they don't have tanks in the wings. They have wetted areas that are sealed and they're full of fuel. And for balance reasons or consumption reasons, you need pumps that'll move fuel from here to there or whatever. So I never deal with those. They're not much of a concern to me. I don't know what type of pump they are, but they don't need to be tremendously accurately metered, so they're most likely a centrifugal non-positive displacement pump. Now what does that mean? It means for each revolution of the shaft of the pump, a varying amount of fuel will move. So the faster the pump goes, the more efficient it is. So for one revolution of the pump at very low speed, it won't move much fuel at all. But at high speed, let's say one revolution moves 200 cc's of fuel. With a positive displacement pump, no matter how slow it goes, or no matter how fast it goes, each revolution moves the exact same amount of fuel. So it can only move more fuel by going faster. These pumps are a little bit different. They are a positive displacement pump, but the displacement is variable. I told you it's always more complicated than you think. So with a swash plate like this, this is the axis of the turning shaft. If the swash plate is flat, it's not doing anything. It's not pumping any fuel because the pistons are sliding on a swash plate, and as they slide, they don't change position in their bores. They just stay there, nothing happens. As you increase the angle of swash, then a piston will be here at one side, and it goes up, and it comes down, it goes up, and it comes down. So that's a pumping action. The greater the swash plate angle, the greater the swept displacement is of the pump. So it's a variable displacement, variable axis? What do they call it? A variable displacement hydraulic pump. And a hydraulic pump is a positive displacement pump. It's much simpler to have a fixed angle on the swash plate. And anyway, positive displacement pump. Different from a boost pump. The advantage of a positive displacement pump is you know that no matter what the speed is, you can calculate based on the speed and the displacement, which is the angle of the swash plate, you can measure that, how much it's pumping. That makes it very useful for carefully metered amounts of fuel. Okay, so we've covered transfer pumps and fuel pumps. What is a boost pump? Okay, so it looks like on the diagram, you've got a boost pump. It's typically in the gas tank, in the jet fuel tank, in a large aircraft, or even a small one. You have a boost pump, and it supplies pressure to the fuel pump, this thing, the engine-driven fuel pump. Now, the engine-driven fuel pump has a very important job. And if it's pulling fuel at a high rate of 20 gallons per minute or 50 or more for a larger engine, the J79 uses 90 gallons a minute in afterburner. And the afterburner fuel pump is powered by 175 horsepower. So it's a serious pump. What a boost pump does is it's there to supply enough pressure at the intake of the fuel pump so that it never starves, it never cavitates the fuel, or it never gets an air bubble, or it never can't get enough. Because once that starts to happen, if the fuel pump can't supply enough fuel, it can't take in enough fuel, it can't supply enough fuel, and you have erratic response of the fuel control, an unpredictable amount of power to the pilot. That ain't good. It's not so bad in an airliner at cruise at 35,000 feet, but if you're in a fighter jet and you're doing something that you have to do, or even if you're just taking off, you don't need a momentary interruption of power. That would be bad, especially between rotation and when they start to cut the power on the climb out on an airliner. You need reliable, massive amounts of power. Even a small fraction of a second of interruption of that power could be disastrous. So anyway, the boost pump supplies pressure at the face of the fuel pump. It doesn't need a lot of pressure because the pumps don't work in sequence. It's not like it's adding pressure that's then added by the fuel pump. It's just there to prevent or to present a reliable supply of pressure to the fuel pump that it can eat from. So these fuel pumps on the Arenda, they're up here driven by gears from the engine. and they can supply up to, well, they're tested up to 2,000 PSI. Typically, they only supply 1,100 or so, and the fuel control supplies up to about 950, I think it's 960, to the fuel nozzles. So it's a high pressure pump. It's a high precision, high pressure pump that's variable. The boost pump on the Aranda, when we're testing these, it says in the testing manual that the boost pressure to the fuel pump needs to be within between 3 and 5 PSI. It could be more. It's no big deal if it's more. Like, we use 15 to 25 PSI boost when testing a J79, but we try to keep it about 10 or below for the Aranda because it doesn't need any more. But when you're testing the pump and calibrating the pump, it has to be exactly between 3 and 5 PSI. So that's what you're looking at as a boost pump. A boost pump just is, it's not boosting the pressure, but it's boosting the flow of fuel. That the fuel tanks are lower than the engine in the Sabre, so it has to move it up there. You don't want the fuel, you don't want the main fuel pumps drawing against a slight vacuum in the line. You just don't want that. You want it to be, I guess, force-fed. Force-fed at 3 PSI, just like Homer Simpson's ranch dressing hose. Exactly like that. So the boost pumps are probably, again, we don't deal with boost pumps either because it's part of the aircraft. It's not part of the engine. But it's an integral part of the overall fuel system of the aircraft. A boost pump is more than likely, I'm making a guess here, I've never seen one, they're probably centrifugal pumps, and so that's a non-positive displacement pump. They probably have a capacity, if they were running, just pumping overboard, like a bilge pump in a boat, they probably have a capacity of 50 to 100 gallons per minute. Massively more than what's needed. But also a centrifugal pump, if you block off the outlet, nothing happens. It just spins. It becomes a fuel stirring instrument rather than a fuel pumping instrument because there's so much, I guess, leakage or slippage of the impeller, it wouldn't be a big deal. Whereas if you had a positive displacement piston pump and you shut off the output, something's going to break. There's either going to be a relief valve that pops. There isn't a relief valve on boost pumps because they don't need one because they're non-positive displacement. But if you had a typical hydraulic system, if you just shut off the output and didn't block the input and you kept turning the hydraulic pump, the pressure is going to go up and up and up and up in the outlet until something gives. Typically the line blows or there's a relief valve. Sorry. So just to explain exactly what a boost pump is, because that's one of those things, like, here's an example for football. To a guy like me, my question has always been, why is it called a down? What does that mean? Nobody's ever explained that to me. And you never see it on the TV. Maybe today, in the Super Bowl, somebody will explain why that thing, that distance, is called a down. I don't need to know, but you can put it in the comments if you want. So the boost pump is the first thing. There's a fuel tank or an area full of fuel. There's a boost pump in there, probably a swinging pickup, or what they do in cars and in weed eaters is just have a flexible line with the pickup on the end and it's weighted and it just falls to the bottom, whichever way the plane's going. The boost pump just takes the fuel that's in the tank, raises it to a pressure of 3 to 5, maybe 10 PSI, and supplies it to the fuel pump. So it's a fuel pump that supplies a fuel pump. You could call it a supply pump, but if you had a fuel tank that was above the engine, the fuel would run into the fuel pump anyway, and you could call that pump a boost pump because it boosts that pressure by a little bit. Boost pump is a good name for it. You could call it a supply pump, and people would say, oh, you're talking about a boost pump. Yeah, that's what I meant. Okay. So I was inspired to give this little explanation because you can tell by the diagrams where the boost pumps are, and Blancolirio talks about the different pumps and tanks and whatever. He mentions boost pump, but like a lot of people who are very familiar with a certain industry or technology, Sometimes it's the littlest details that can be confusing to somebody who doesn't know them. And I wanted to help out with that by explaining what a boost pump was and how it's different. It's a supply. It's a little supply to the fuel pump to make the job of the fuel pump easier and to make sure that the fuel pump never starves for fuel. There you go. Even though it looks like there's a boost pump in cars, I think the fuel pump in a car that's in the gas tank is the fuel pump. I'm pretty sure. I could be wrong, but that little thing supplies, I think they're 170 PSI, something like that, to the injectors. Car engines are completely different from jet engines, so don't trust me when I explain anything about car engines, okay? Hope you guys have a good Super Bowl. I might actually try to tune into a little bit of it, but like I said, the most interesting things are that thing and the commercials. So I might just watch a highlights of it tomorrow. Otherwise, thanks for watching and have a great Super Bowl Sunday 2024.